This is real good content. We should actually just drop this. I don't give a.
No, so something about wearing a hoodie makes me fucking feel very like just.
New York hip hop. Yeah.
I feel like it's coming. He's like, yo,
I can already tell.
He's like, yo, here comes the New York hip hop. Like, yeah, man. Like, I got on the black hood, man. Yo, just.
Hold up, son.
Wow. Yeah. To all the killers and the $100 billers. For real, because who ain't got no feelings. Feelings. Check it out now. I got you stuck off the realness. We be the infamous, you heard of us. Official Queensbridge murderers. Tomorrow comes equipped for warfare. Beware of my crime family who got enough shots to share. For all those who wanna profile and pose, rock you in your face, stab your brain with your nose bone. You all alone in these streets, cousin. Every man for themselves in his land. We be gunning and keep them show crews running like they supposed to. They come around but they never come close to. I can see it inside your face. You're in the wrong place. Cowards like you just get their whole body laced up with bullet holes and such. Speak the wrong words, man, and you will get touched. You can put your whole army against my team. I guarantee you it'll be your very last time breathing. Your simple words just don't move me. You're minor, you're major. You're all up in the game and don't deserve to be a player. Don't make me have to call your name out. You're cool as featherweight. My gunshots will make you levitate. I'm only 19, but my mind is older. When the things get for real, my warm heart turns cold. Another nigga deceased, another story gets told. It ain't nothing. Really,
and yo done sparked the Philly, so I could get my mind off these yellow
back niggas.
Let's not even do the pause, let's just go rob somebody.
You wanna go rob some motherfuckers right now?
Like, why do we even have to do the pause, bro? Like,
I'll go rob motherfuckers with you right now.
Yo, I'll let me go take my shoes.
Yo.
Yeah. I was
drive up and down Harlem blocks, iced out watch,
knocks like,
on socks, cops, they
go
selling
so nice.
Rocks, pulling me over to see if I'm drunk,
but
I'm
so
bored they wouldn't
the
fuck with me
killed.
If I don't put no more, listen, Columbo, you might because your money comes slow, and what you're making a year,
like, yo,
I'm making
if
one
story
show,
came out,
you want to frisk me
and
it
was
search
like,
my ride,
like,
told me all kind of names, try to hurt my pride,
you
just mad because I'm a young cat,
pockets
dump back, talking about where the gun at, I've been there. And done that. I thought that illegal life, I'm staying legit. I love to see cars come cruising by playing my shit. I walk around with six down without a pistol. My whole clique's wild. I'm rich pal, no more sticks. I'm making hits now. I drink crystal. I'm through breaking laws. I don't sell coke anymore. I do chores. So get that flashlight out of my face to bring me down. Them jakes to do whatever it takes. Rolled up them federals. Got my phone and my house tapped. Praying that I fall for the mouse trap. I doubt that. Why do I end up in so much shit, I done can't wait.
Oh my god, hold up. Yo, fam, and this will actually go into like a topic that we have later on the pod, but like that idea of just like how much I feel like today's generation don't know just how crazy Big L was.
Yeah. He has a level of talent that really, if you didn't, and this is going to go into one of my points later, but I'll reiterate it in a better way later. But you really kind of had to be big.
Yeah.
Like, the craft of rapping, we can talk about bodies of work and cultural, like, nuance and, like, who's out now. The craft of rapping, in general, has gotten better. But that that Ron style,
yo,
that quality, I don't know, bro. Like, the first time I heard Big L, I remember going,
yo, what is this?
Who is that?
Yeah.
But that was my reaction. And then I had to replay what I just heard.
Yeah.
I think the first thing I actually heard from L might not have been an L song. I think it might have been the Jay-Z Back and Forth freestyle on Stress and Libido.
Yep.
And then I had heard, because I had remember hearing what's the joint with the Biggie sample? It was like on rotation on BET, but I remember kind of ignoring it because it had the same sample.
Yeah.
So, but I was like a kid, you know, so I didn't really put two and two together. So
yeah.
Like, oh, maybe I should just listen to the bars and like see what the quality of the rhymer is. But like, L's talent, man, it was just ridiculous. Man, no. I don't know if I've been that impressed since, to be quite honest. Like the first time, like as a rap listener, there's nothing better than getting put onto a new MC and being impressed by him, right?
Yeah.
Like the level of impressed for me with L was just like, I don't know if it ever got any higher.
I don't know that but bro, because he was just, it was the wordplay, it was the way he put everything together was just, it was next to none. Yeah. And there's just one more joint that, it made me think of it, because when you mentioned, when you hear an MC for the first time, and you're just immediately just like, yo, it made me think of this joint. Yo, Nas,
stop playing.
Yo, Nas came through and he said, what?
Streets disciple, my rap's a trifle. I shoot slugs from my brain just like a rifle. Stampede the stage, I leave the microphone split. Play Mr. Tuffy while I'm on some pretty tone shit. Verbal assassin, my architect pleases. When I was 12, I went to hell for snuffing Jesus. Nasty Nas is a rebel to America. Police murderer, I'm causing hysteria. My troops roll up with a strange force. I was trapped in a cage and lit out by the main source. Swimming in women like a lifeguard. Put on a bulletproof nigga, I strike hard. Kidnapped the president's wife without a plan. And hanging niggas like the Ku Klux Klan. I melt mics till the sound waves over. Before stepping to me, I'd rather step to Jehovah. Slamming MCs on cement. Cause verbally, I'm iller than an AIDS patient. I move swift and uplift your mind. Shoot the gift when I rip and rhyme. Rapping sniper, speaking real words. My thoughts react like Steven Spielberg. Poetry attacks, paragraphs punch hard. My brain is insane, I'm out to lunch guard. Science is dropped, my raps are toxic. My voice box locks and excels like a rocket.
My voice box locks and excels like a rocket. Yo.
I almost feel like we should play some, Lil Yachty for a concert.
Yeah. Yo, and I think that's where, for me, when I'm a hip-hop head. Like, I love rap music. Yeah. It's shit like that that just got me excited growing up. But I would hear shit like that. I was like, yo, what?
Yeah, I think, so it goes back to something that's been really entertaining for me. You know Aries Spears formerly from Mad TV?
Yes.
He's notorious now for his podcast and his sort of quote unquote old head opinions. So he's super duper duper pro Jordan over everything else and super duper pro boom bap era over every other type of hip hop.
Of course.
I think he's right on both fronts, but it's so funny that he's so passionate about it because he gets in arguments with 18-year-olds and I'm like, why? Why are you wasting your time? But he had the perfect analogy when describing the first time he heard DMX.
Yeah.
He said lyrically DMX had an incredible first step, like a guard.
Yes.
And I understood exactly what he meant. He was talking about the first time he heard X was on Money, Power, Respect.
Yep.
And he was talking about the way that he rhymes and the way that his bars went together. He was like, he had a first step that was a quick guard, that could bring you from right to left really quick. And I remember whenever I've heard a first really great MCs, first rhyme, I've always thought do they have that? Do they have that amazing
mm-hmm.
The first time you hear them and they're there needs to be a sharpness when you first hear a great MC.
Who was the last MC that did that for you? Because I think so. Because here's the reason why I say this, because I'm not saying the last new artist that you started rocking, because there are some artists for example, obviously that will grow on you over time. You'll start rocking with them more and more. You know what I'm saying? I think there were some artists who I listened to and it took a few tracks for me to get interested with them. So artists like DaBaby who you hear him, he makes an impact on you, but it takes a few songs before
he had to grow on me.
Yeah, he grew on me over time.
But first time, first rhyme, immediately you knew how good he was type of stuff.
Because I already have one in my mind that I was just yo.
I don't want to reach back to pre-2000. That's too easy. Post-2000, MC Hart heard the first time and I was like, yo.
Yeah, you're like, yo, hold up.
Definitely Lupe on Touch the Sky.
Ooh, that's definitely a good one. That's a good one. That's a good one. Yeah,
I remember hearing him, and I was just like, Lupus. I remember thinking after that verse, I was like, okay, I have to find out who this is, and I got to hear all of his stuff.
Yeah.
And I was like, yo, that's a good one. If he's on mixtapes, I need to get the mixtapes. If he's rhyming on this, I need to get on that. Like, if he's one of Kanye's like artists, I need to find out what the project is. Definitely him. I always liked Kendrick Lamar, but I wasn't blown away by him.
Yeah, Kendrick wouldn't be on my list for that because I think it took a few listens. I don't know that there was one pivotal Kendrick verse that I heard and I was just like
I thought he would be good. Races. I thought it would be good. That wasn't in question, but first time oh my god, first time I heard L, or even to reach back, but the first time I heard Eminem, first of all, I didn't think he was white. That was number one. I was like, this black dude's kind of weird. He's kind of quirky. He's got a different style. But recent times,
I don't know that M did that for me. 50 definitely did. 50 did that to me. I mean, I was living in Queens, so I was like, man, there was no way.
I had something similar to him that I had to Kendrick Lamar. I knew this was going to be big, but it didn't necessarily grab me. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I was sort of, I don't know, I was caught in between him and Lloyd Banks. I thought, obviously, Lloyd Banks had the lyrical talent, but I knew, given his personality, he would never really be able to, ascend to where 50 was going to get.
Yeah.
Because you need, obviously, I mean, it's been an old disgruntled rap fan opinion, but it's true. Skills itself doesn't really get you there. You can have all the talent in the world and not mean anything.
Well, of course, because, I mean, I think, and that's something that you've kind of seen with dudes like Lloyd Banks, where it's just he has the skills, but it's also yo, man, do you want to be that, big in music anyway, because that's really where I feel Banks falls into. Falls into the realm of a motherfucker who yo, I'm better than 90% of rappers, but I don't want to have the fame of the top 10%. I don't want to be there with y'all. Y'all can have that.
Yeah, and he's he has this underlying shyness. He also doesn't make great records. You need to have other things.
Fam, yo, the fact that the Bobby Shmurda track was on Lloyd Banks' album, that beat was on his album and did nothing, and then Bobby got it and turns it into the biggest song of that year. It just kind of goes to show the fact that he ain't really want
I got one. J Electronica. I heard him and I was okay. But I knew personality wise he would have the same struggles though.
Yeah.
He's such a weird enigma.
And I never got into J Electronica.
He's one who I think is against supreme talent, but you have to understand success in the music industry is so many other factors.
Yeah.
And he just doesn't have the other things.
Yeah, for sure. I think for me, the two that come to mind immediately, I think, are Cole and Big Sean. So J. Cole on Looking for Trouble. Mm. When he comes in, it's like, cold world, make way for the chosen one. What you now hear is putting fear in all the older ones. Downplay me to downgrade me like they don't know. And I was just like, what? The combination of that and the fact that, at that time, I was working in the computer lab. And we're working in the computer lab with Phil. And I remember I came in and I had on, I think I had on some, shades and, a backwards hat or whatever. I had on, a backwards fitted, right? Had to fit it on backwards, and I had on some shades heading into the computer lab for work with Phil. And Phil was just like, boy, you like J. Cole. And I was like, who? He's like, you don't know who J. Cole is?
Oh, yeah.
He's like, you don't know who J. Cole is? I was like, nah, I really have not heard of J. Cole. And then maybe within that same week is when Kanye was doing the Good Fridays.
Mm.
Looking for Trouble was on there, and I was like, ooh.
Yeah.
And then from there, Friday Night Lights, I went back, listened to that, and then, yo, I was
off. You know what's tricky about that, too? It's rappers just don't debut the same way before.
No.
The way that they used to get on was, this dude seemingly came out of nowhere. He'd hop on this posse cut with, somebody who was established, and then that would sort of be their credibility.
Yeah.
And then if the verse was, amazing, he'd be like, yo, who's the new guy?
Who's that? What is this?
So now dudes come into the game with, this long rap sheet. Oh, they've been on, mixtapes, or they, know them before you know them kind of thing. And now, with everything being super digital, you can have an online presence independently.
Mm-hmm.
Now you don't need to wait for a cosign. So, yeah, I don't know. You probably won't see that. Anymore.
No, I don't think so.
Live at the Barbecue was the first Nas.
Yo.
That
was the first time you heard Nas was Nas. He was who is that?
Yeah, and it made you want to ask about it. And off the strength of that, you could get a deal.
True. Yeah, off of a verse.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's wild. That's wild. Where my manners? I should do an intro.
Yes, you did an intro.
Right? Welcome all to episode number 54 of the What Are We Talking About? All right, we've been drinking.
We have.
Welcome one, welcome all to episode number 54 of the What Are We Even Talking About podcast. I am your host, Izzy. Here with a very, very special guest. He's back once again, y'all.
Two-time champ.
Two-time champ. Vegan Superman is in the building. Are you still vegan?
Yeah.
Really?
I should like patent that, though. That's really good, vegan Superman.
You no, but like, are you like full-blown vegan now? Is that like the thing?
I tell people I'm a bad vegan.
You're so, a like, bad vegan?
So my diet is mostly vegan, and then like, depending on circumstances, I may dabble in something else every now and then. But for the most part,
not
it's
pork.
Like, vegan. Like, I haven't had pork since like the early 2000s.
You don't miss bacon? Really?
Nah.
I've noticed, because it's funny too. Somewhere in my algorithms on YouTube, it's now shown me like different meals made vegan, and it really all spawned from like one video that caught my attention of like a dude turning carrots into bacon.
What?
Yeah, he's like, yeah, yo, you can make like, yo, like, and it's just like, it was like a whole science experience. He's like, oh, you got some like Worcestershire, and you got some of this and some of that, and whatever, whatever. And he like made it into bacon, and I was like, all right. And now I'm like, my algorithm thinks I'm vegan and like just keeps showing me this shit, and it's the most interesting content ever because I keep watching it. So I'm like, yo, how the fuck are you gonna turn like this into that? Like, how are you gonna make a vegan cheesesteak?
I mean, honestly, that's too much work for me.
It is.
Like, I have lots of opinions, but my opinion stops where my work begins. So, like, if I have to like do lots of extra stuff to make something happen, it's not for me. I don't care what my politics are.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, that makes sense. As we get going, I will say that today's episode is sponsored by Milliennium Enterprises. Tax season is upon us, people. Holla at Milliennium Enterprises. Get your taxes done. If you need any sort of translation, holla at them. Immigration paperwork, they do it all. Holla at your boys. They are located on 270 Manton Ave in Providence, Rhode Island. Their information is somewhere on this screen. Future and More Sober Izzy has put it somewhere accordingly. Holla at them. The phone number is 401-227-0414. And part of what they sponsored. So last year, because they did a sponsor spot last year on the pod.
Oh, I didn't even know that.
Right? Yeah. They did a sponsor spot last year on the pod. They actually, they're real tight with Sammy. So shout out to them for still doing the sponsor spot this year. Right? Last year, it was like, all right, you know, y'all sponsorship, y'all, we're like, all right, like their contribution was like our drinks, right? So they bought us drinks last year, pretty much, right? This year, because I was like, yo, man, my boy Dre is here. I got to take advantage of my boy Dre being here.
Uh-oh.
All right?
No pressure.
No pressure? No pressure. Because I was like, it's very important that if I got Dre here, if I'm going to do this with anybody, it's going to be with my boy Dre. All right? So something special for you. You ready?
I'm ready.
So, because my brother Dre is here, we got some Beyond Fried Chicken in the house for my brother. Vegan Superman. Wow. I had to get these for you.
You know what is funny about this? I keep seeing this meme online that's really making me mad because it's so funny. And it was like they showed the product, right? So the KFC Beyond Fried Chicken and the like, I don't know whether it always looks like that, but like the like I assume when it's tofu based, like innards.
Yeah.
We're there, and it was like, they really gonna have dudes out here eating erasers. I seen that, and it was just like almost like the type of logic that goes behind getting roasted in a school lunchroom.
Yeah, pretty, I'm yo.
Like, I ain't eating that. Like, yo, I almost pretty much. I didn't want it anymore.
I was like, yo, and this isn't Chris and Tevin's show through the true. I was like, yo, nah, like I gotta try these vegan joints, and I gotta have Dre to try these.
Wow, I didn't even know those were out yet. I heard about it. Yeah, man.
Yo, exclusive. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, look at yo.
Okay.
All right, so let's give these a try. Get in there, B. Yo, this is what y'all be doing, huh? This is what y'all
I'm so attacked right now, yo, man.
All right, cheers, brother. Cheers, G.
I mean, chicken on the pocket. This is awful.
I don't know, man.
I mean, I don't hate it.
I didn't know I wouldn't hate it. Like, I really don't hate it.
No, I don't. But so, as someone who eats a lot of this stuff, I must tell you, as somebody who's probably skeptical about such things, there is fried chicken that is such higher quality than this. Like, legit, I can get you a bag of it, and you might not eat chicken again. It's that good.
Yo.
But this is fast food, so you kind of have to lower your expectations.
Yeah, no. I have somebody who's, like, a boy and red carnivore, and, like...
Is he not old? Okay.
I've always said, like, I would bite into a cow's neck if it wasn't so frowned upon. Like, if people wouldn't look at me like I was crazy, I'd 100% be down for it. But, like, yo, this is not bad, bro. Like, I'm really not mad. Like, I'm not going to lie. If you gave me this and told me, like, yo, yeah, it's just nuggets, I wouldn't tell you that it wasn't chicken.
I don't regret eating this. What? This is the best thing I could really say.
Yeah, I'll be honest.
Okay.
I don't know that I would have been like, yo, this is just kind of like some kind of like whack nuggets. But, like,
yeah,
I don't know that I would have gone as far as to be like, yo, nah, this ain't chicken.
The texture's not weird either.
Yeah, like, that's the part that gets me. Yo.
Okay. We did that.
Okay. Damn. We'll finish the rest of these later. You can take these home. you can have these. That's your dinner.
That's a blessing. Thank you.
You know what I'm saying? So, shout out to Millennium Enterprises for sponsoring tonight's dinner. You know, you vegans don't eat too much.
I really don't. Wow.
Wow. All right. What are we even talking about?
What a way to start.
What a way to start. What are we even talking about? All right. I'll be honest. I didn't realize it until I started, like, looking through the topics list. I was like, a lot of our shit is sport.
Yeah, this is real heavy sports last time. Yeah, heavy, you but know even, what it was, though? Last time we spoke, there was so much nonsense going on that we had sports and was only able to touch on it for, like, 7 minutes.
Pretty much. But kind of just sticking on the topic of rap music, though.
Okay, let's do it.
I did want to just talk about this whole idea of, like, rap lyrics being used for court, like, in court, submitted to court for, like, evidence. My understanding is, like, it's Jay, it's Meek. There's, like, a couple dudes who are, like, actively fighting against this from happening.
Yeah.
Wouldn't be surprised if, like, Diddy's involved in it, too. But, yeah, they're looking to, like, be able to use, like, rap lyrics, which we have seen done historically for some people. I'm hot and cold on the subject, I'll be honest.
Yeah.
I'm hot and cold on it. Just because I think when you get into like certain like real cases and dudes is talking about like unresolved murders and like you're rapping about shit that only the motherfucker who like killed this dude would know about this. It's like, aye, fam. Like,
smack on your man's like a smack Johnny Guinness.
Like, yo.
Okay, what'd he say? We really sure? Like, hit him with the headset.
Like, yo, my man's, you, hold up. What you just say? Like, that's a real, like, because that I understand, like, because that's where I think that when it comes to, like, legalities,
yeah,
it's hard to draw the line because for me, I'm like, yeah, if you have other, like, real evidence,
yeah,
and like the lyrics are completely supporting the fact that this dude is just rapping about like real life shit that he committed. Yeah. He's like rapping about like these are like fucking Tay K on the race.
Yeah.
Then it's like, all right, you know what? Like, this is a little wild. But if it's like you hear a motherfucker rap about some shit and you have no leads, no nothing, and then you just hear some rap lyrics and you're like, nah, yo, it's him. He said it on the like, yo, you like confessed right here. That's a little different.
Yeah, I mean, so first of all, it's racism. Let's get that out of the open. Let's get the elephant in the room out there on the table. Clearly, it's racism. They do it at the country singers.
Yep.
Like, was it Johnny Cash had a song? I shot a man in Reno just to watch him die. I cannot imagine in any world they would arrest him for that nonsense. It says right here that you shot a man in Reno. Where were you last Thursday?
And we have this unsolved murder that happened in Reno.
Coincidence or evidence? Like, it's we gotta really have consistent metrics for this type of stuff, right? And so the logic that would even seem to support it is kind of paper thin. So if we're talking about somebody's lyrics being possible evidence, it's like, well, who's to say it's actually valid, right? So I say that to like point to a lot of what I've kind of debated people with like-minded opinions on pop culture as far as like the Dave Chappelle criticism fallout, right?
Yeah.
So where people have taken him to task, I think on some level, understandably so, about his trans jokes. And my challenge has always been, okay, well, who's to say that he's saying things the way that he means it? And they're like, oh, well, he's saying he's a turf on stage. And I say, yes, that's true. And that's awful. But he also said he has sex with his wife's feet when she goes to sleep. So, like, where's the reality? You know what I mean? And so if I'm a prosecutor, like, yeah, I'm going to seize upon whatever is going to help my case. But there's always going to be a little bit of area where there's deniability, right?
Yeah.
Like, if I'm a New York rapper and I'm rapping about killing somebody in New York, and I just happen to catch a charge about something violent, they're like, they could easily be like, well, he's clearly violent. Look at the lyrics. It's like, I'm just writing.
Yeah.
Why is my self-expression in my art considered to be evidence? Because, again, we don't do that for every artistic medium, right?
No.
Nobody, if we're going to do that for rap lyrics, I think we got to do it for movies. We got to do it for paintings. We got to do it for everything. Or is it just rappers, i.e. racism?
Very true, because I also don't know that I'd imagine them coming down on fucking Eminem for anything he said in his lyrics. Or
we know why. I mean, shout out to Eminem. He's one of the greatest rappers ever. He can rap his ass off. But like, bro, come on. Let's not even do this.
Yeah.
I wish his music was better. But
I do too. I've never been too wild. Like, I think M, and it's funny too, they... For as much as, like, you know, people, there's, like, that the narrative exists of, like, M is, like, you know, one of the greatest of all time and all that stuff. I've always been of the ilk of, like, yeah, but, like, do y'all realize that, like, not a lot of, black America, like, hardcore hip-hop heads, like, they didn't rock with M as heavily as, like, the rest of America was rocking with M.
Well, yeah, so that's for a few reasons. One, like, and I spent a lot of time in, like, super-duper, like, laughably, like, pro-black circles. And for a lot of those cats, like, Eminem was always a non-starter because his presence in the medium was kind of the offense, right? In other words, the fact that you're a white dude and you come into this genre populated and dominated by black people of an urban society and you seem to rocket to fame and success and money seems almost like an affront to the art form, right? Because you're not going to be judged on the same scale, right? Like, so if you're a white rapper, it's not guaranteed that you're necessarily going to be successful. But it is something that you're going to get certain legs up and certain doors open for you and not be judged on the same scale as your peers.
Yes.
So if you're not being judged on the same scale as your peers, it's like, can we really put you in the same category as these other dudes who are having to scrap and claw, right? How hard was it for Jay-Z to become Jay-Z? You know what I mean? Like, Eminem didn't have that hard.
Yo, and even then, in 2022, there is still, like, conservatives out there who will look at Jay-Z and try to label him as just a former drug dealer. Like, yo, fuck y'all, man. Like,
that's what I'm saying. So, like, if it's we're discussing, you know, not to get off on something else, but like, if we're talking about like white dudes' presence in like hip hop, I'm fine with them. But you got to be judged the same way. You got to pass the same test and all that.
Yeah, and I think that's where, like, with M, when it comes to just like, I think another thing that always like strikes against him when it comes to motherfuckers that was like living in the hood and shit, like, yo, I can't relate to your content, B.
Well, I mean, the running joke amongst our friends has been Eminem died in a plane crash in 2002.
Yep.
It was like he was going to be something special. Yeah. After that Eminem show came out, it would have been over, and then he just died. I don't know what happened to him.
I don't know what happened. I mean,
if we're talking talent in a vacuum, yes, he can rap his ass off. The mechanical, like, of crafting rhymes, absolutely, he's amazing. But I don't listen to Eminem, not really.
Nah, not at all.
Like, I remember there's been, like, this weird online debate about verses. It's, every time someone throws up Eminem, I just be like, bro, if I gotta listen to Eminem for 2 hours, I'm jumping out a window.
Yeah, I don't care who he's against.
Yeah.
It's I will L. not
listen. Forget
not,
that. I took the L. I lost my
beard. I will not there. Listen. To, like, I'm not gonna lie. I would be so upset at, because I did see a lot of people talk about M versus J. And honestly, I would be, like, absurdly upset with that,
right?
Because of the reasoning that it's like kind of like what you said, like, yo, if you put M in a versus, like, I'm not gonna sit there and watch it, but if it's M and J, I'm now forced to watch it. Like, like, the New York bias in me is not going to be able to refrain from watching that. So now I need to put myself through the self-torture of listening to fucking Superman go up against public service announcement. And I'm like, why are we doing this? Why is this here?
Yeah, I mean, he's a really hard dude to really, like, judge in a historical sense, too, because one of the main hits against M is that he doesn't have club joints. He doesn't have really bumpable songs. He doesn't really have joints. He doesn't have joints for the ladies. Doesn't have joints for the dudes, really. It's just like he has this own sort of niche rap style that only really works for him. And so Versus isn't about talent necessarily. It's about like moments and like, oh, do you remember when this song came out? Yep. Oh my God, public service announcement was such a big deal when it dropped.
Bro.
And, oh my God, what are you going to do when Jay puts on like Girl Off Your Shoulder? What count is that? Like, I got like three Eminem joints off the top I can tell you that I love. And then after that, it's a huge trail off.
Yo, fam.
Like,
yeah.
Like, how many Eminem joints do you listen to? Like, oh, yeah, I'm glad this Eminem song came
out. I'll be honest, I don't know that I've ever played an Eminem song willingly. I've never played one.
That might be a bar. That might be a classic, isn't
it? Yo, I've never, because that's really what it is. That's what it comes down to with M. For me, I've never... having free will and full control of the ox. Been like, yo, you know what I want to hear right now? I really want to hear the real Slim Shady. I'm putting that on right now. Like, I've never gone to it like that. Like, for me, it's always been, like, all of my encounters with Eminem, and mind you, this is someone who can adamantly say, like, yes, I've listened to, like, full Eminem albums, but it's been, like, I'm with somebody who wants to just listen to the full Eminem. Like, it's just been other reasoning behind it. It's never been me wanting to be like, yo, man, I'm trying to, like, evoke this emotion in myself. Like, and I want to go and, like, listen to Eminem.
And to contextualize, too, like, my latent Eminem fandom, too, it's always been the stuff he did really before he kind of blew. Because Eminem pre-signing is actually one of the greatest rappers I've ever heard.
Insane.
Yeah. Like, his talent makes no sense.
Bro.
Like, if you listen to, like, when he was, like, freestyling on a wake-up show and all that stuff, you understand why he got signed.
Oh, yeah. You understand two things. You understand, A, why he got signed, and B, why he was so heavily respected by other MCs to where it was just like, nah, I'm not trying to battle this dude.
Well, yeah. So that's why to this day when you hear Jay-Z or Talib Kweli or somebody talk about Eminem, it's glowing praise because they remember that guy.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's like, to me, it's like Jordan on the Wizards. It's like, I love Jordan because I saw him when he was flying through the air, bro. But like, he was not that guy. Like, yeah. I mean, he's not. I'm not listening. Anyway.
That's actually a perfect. What are we even talking about? That's actually a perfect segue, though. That leads us right into sports because fuck the bullshit. We talking about some sports. Dwayne Wade.
Ooh.
And oddly enough, this is still very fresh. I purposely didn't talk about this last week because I was like, I really want to talk about this with Dre.
Oh, who was there last week?
Tap. Brandon.
Oh, that was special. Shout out to Tap.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I can't talk about D-Wade and Jordan with a white man. Ain't no way. I can't let that happen.
I love you, Tap.
I love you, Tap, but I can't let that happen. I just cannot. It's just, my God.
It's all love when I see you, boy. I got a drink on you.
Like, because I'm really about to shit on a black man right now. I agree with Dwayne Wade. So what Dwayne Wade said was that Jordan will eventually be forgotten in the GOAT conversation, similar to what like Kareem and Magic and the people before him. I agree. I don't know how you feel about that, but I agree with that shit.
I agree and I don't. I have both sides of it. I'm actually in between. But go ahead.
So my thinking is, the reason why I say I agree is because that's what happens with everything. You think about, because that's where, when we were thinking about, when we were listening to music earlier, and I played some Big L.
Yeah.
You immediately was like, ooh, yup, Big L, the enemy, y'all, right? You're there, right? Do you feel that would be the same thing with the next generation of people? You know what I'm saying? Like, you slowly start to see, like, yo, like, they quickly become forgotten because that's what happens naturally.
Yeah.
You don't, like, when we're talking about the greatest rappers of all time, like, we're slowly moving away from, like, because before, there was a time when greatest rapper of all time, it had to be Big or Pac. You couldn't say if it was either. You couldn't say anyone other than those two names.
Yeah.
Now we're at a place where it's just like, oh, it's Hov.
Yeah.
Right? It's Hov, and then there are other people in like that from that same generation would be like, yo, it's Hov, and then somebody might be like, nah, yo, it's Wayne, or like somebody might be like, whatever. But it's like, it's no longer Big and Pac in that conversation, right?
At the very least, it's not solid. Like it's not. It doesn't have a grip on it.
No, it doesn't really. No, it doesn't.
Yeah.
So, and I think when you think about Jordan, you reach this like. Just like bookend, where it was just like, all right, like you're no longer gonna talk about Kareem and Magic and Wilt and Dr. J and all these, you know, nobody bringing up Oscar Robinson in the mix for anything. You know what I'm saying?
So underrated, by the way.
Yeah, extremely.
No one gives a fuck.
Nobody gives a fuck about Oscar Robinson.
He was so nice.
Nobody gives a fuck. No one gives a fuck. Right? And you know, we're still definitely in this era of like, yo, Jordan's the GOAT, like that's the thing. Yeah. But like, is that going to still be the case in another, like, 10 years, 15, 20 years? Where it's like, yo, the people who – it's no different than when you go to the barbershop, you see the old dude in the corner who's like – who refuses to acknowledge Jordan as the GOAT. Who's just like, nah, it's Kareem. It's like, the old head's going to die out too. So the motherfuckers who say that Jordan is the greatest of all time, like, they will die out too. And it's going to be like, nah, yo, it's Bron, it's Kobe, it's
– yeah.
Like, he's going to be forgotten in that sense, in that GOAT conversation.
Yeah, so actually, I think Dwayne Wade is actually right and wrong. I think he's right for a lot of the points that you made, but I think he's right in a sense where no one's really looking into the technical aspect of it.
No.
Which is like, a lot of this stuff is really just based on memory and the devices or areas in which we are able to hold on to these moments, right? So in other words, like, each era of sports, or you can relate it to anything, pop culture, music, anything, it's as vibrant as the medium that retains it. So in other words, like, there's not any HD footage of Wilt, really. Like, we had a clip that went, like, viral a couple weeks ago, and it was the first time a lot of people had seen him in color. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. How crazy that is? This dude who had these crazy, ridiculous numbers, this is the first time we're seeing him moving live.
Yeah.
Like, you know what I mean? It's like being told about, like, Thomas Edison.
Yep.
You know what I mean? And it's like, because for real, there's not a lot of footage of Will.
Yeah.
It's not. Like, I've seen it in what I see. Like, I'm obviously a sports head. So, like, I can get the subtle nuances of it. Mm-hmm. I can see. I understand. Like, I'm a numbers hound. I always thought Russell was better, but that's just me. But it helps tremendously when we get to a point where you start to see regular footage in the 80s. There wasn't regular footage of basketball in the 60s and 70s. Not like that. And for a long time, the NBA was tape delayed.
Yeah.
So imagine the finals and you got to wait 4 hours to see it because they record it and then they cut it down.
Yep.
And then they show you the parts of it that they think are like worthy of seeing. And you don't know who won the title unless you have a cousin that lives in California and he calls you. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So each generation gets certain things that kind of propel it forward and kind of make it a lot more important, right? So the 80s now, it's no longer tape delayed. In the 90s, we start to have, it's the beginning of like higher definition footage, but there's not a lot of it, and it only really gets used for Jordan.
Yeah, it's all Jordan.
It's all Jordan. It's
really all Jordan.
There's not really a lot of HD 90s footage. And like, all that money went to the Bulls. So he's right in that sense, where it's really on the shoulders of whoever was there to experience it live to really tell us like how it was. But those voices will eventually get drowned out because it's almost like, you and I get in lots of talks about like trying to put younger generation kids onto like great rappers, right?
Mm-hmm.
And we keep finding the same thing is that like younger cats, like under 20, they don't want to hear quote unquote good music. They want to hear artists that they know.
Yeah.
That's a totally different thing. You can tell somebody's like the greatest MC ever. They don't care. They want to hear Lil Yachty.
Yeah.
Like,
you know what I mean? Put my shit on.
That's not what they want to hear. They want to hear Big L's like complicated rapping and that doesn't impress them.
No.
And so, for a long time, with the debate with Jordan versus whomever, has been like things that make Jordan the GOAT are stagnant, right? Which is like the accomplishments at the heat of it, being on this all-time great team, the titles, the fact that he never really lost in a big game scenario. But the things that we're going to see going forward, that stuff isn't going to shine as bright.
No.
So in that sense, he's correct. Where I think he's wrong is, and I think it's probably just a misspeak on his part, But I don't think Jordan will be forgotten. It'll be that there'll be less voices to really support the claim, which is something that's kind of different. Forgotten. So Jordan culturally remains vibrant, right? And it's because, first of all, let's not undersell the fact that dudes still line up for his sneakers, which is crazy.
Well,
like, I didn't do that when I was supposed to do that. And for some reason, dudes still do that, right?
Oh, of course.
What keeps somebody going forth? Do you have to have something about you that keeps you sustained through the future? It's like with Michael Jackson, right? Michael Jackson had been dead 10 years. But, like, even prior to his death, he was still, like, globally, like, huge, yeah. Which is crazy, right? Because he had things that, like, didn't go stale, basically. Like, the Thriller video and the accompanying choreography, yeah. All that never went stale. It was still a Halloween staple. You got to have things that keep you in the public eye or still continue to keep you iconic. So I think Jordan, just time-wise, some luster has to come off the name. Like, that Denver doesn't happen, right? Like, at one point, James Brown was the biggest artist in the world, and then he got old.
Yeah. I mean, I think what I think about Jordan, it isn't that – and I don't think D-Wade definitely meant that he'll be completely forgotten. Yeah. Forgotten in that conversation of, like, the go and forgotten in just in that aspect.
Yeah.
Where I put it is in the same place as, like, how John Madden's coaching has been forgotten. That's where I put where Jordan is at. Like, people don't remember John Madden as a coach.
Yeah, no.
I don't know the last time I heard someone talk about, like, when people talk, like, yo, greatest coaches of all time and whatever, like, who the fuck is bringing up John Madden?
Yeah.
It's not happening. You think John Madden, you think about the football game.
I think about Mad TV, I'm not gonna lie.
No, or Mad TV. Or Mad TV.
Frank Caliendo was killing him.
Yeah, but, like, that's what I mean, though. Yeah. You're not thinking about, like, yo, you know, as, like, the coach or whatever. So I feel like at some point with Jordan,
yeah,
it's going to be like, yeah, I know Jordan is, like, yeah, he was a basketball player. He was the best of his time. But it's the sneakers. That's what's keeping it, like, relevant.
I also think a lot of that, too, has to do with the 24-hour news cycle and social media, which are things that weren't really in work before. So I also think it's going to be this weird sort of washout scenario where they're going to be people inserted into it quicker as a result of it. So in other words, I think the whole system by which we grade greatness is actually going to change. And it's going to be harder to see people sustain for a long time, right? So, like, obviously, Kobe, rest in peace, is gone now, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so, but a lot of people were trying to insert him into the debate. But because basketball moves, well, sports news moves faster now, now we're inserting other people. I've heard people straight up claim KD is the GOAT.
Stop that.
I don't think it's accurate, but I understand why they would say it.
I think, yeah, the issue with the news cycle now, is like, I think that 24-hour news cycle, is that it's a complete washout of both the good and the bad.
Yeah.
So, like, if you know, Bron has, like, a fucking crazy game on Tuesday.
Yep.
If Lakers lose on Thursday, then, yo, nah, he's not the GOAT anymore. Like, it is literally, like, a washout of whatever happened before.
Information is way, way too quick. And it's just, like, we don't take the time to really sit on information and contextualize everything because the pressure is always to be first with information, right? And so we went over this a little bit in the group earlier this week, right? Dudes tore LeBron to shreds because he wanted to get 30 points. And they were like, yo, see? He ain't really about it. See, just dude over here, the Lakers is losing. He went over and he got like 30 points he didn't need, but at least he got his 30. It was just like, and then the game before that, he was like trash. But in the game before that, it was like, oh my God, he carried the team on his back. So it's like, which one is it?
Yeah, exactly. And it's always, I think, with certain high profile polarizing figures, it's always going to be the negative for them oftentimes, or it's just like, I think LeBron, I firmly believe that he's someone who will never get appreciated until he's no longer, like, in the league. It'll be after he retires that he's, like, firmly appreciated for his contributions.
He's probably the biggest victim in basketball of the 24-hour news cycle. Both good and bad, though. He gets some things that he gains as a result of it, but he takes a lot of hits because of it, too. And so I always knew it was nonsense, and it was just a lot of it was just clickbait. When I realized the things I was praising LeBron for, no one else was. And the things I was criticizing him for, no one else was.
Yeah.
Because it's all about, like, whatever kind of gets the juices going, whatever gets Skip Bayless to, like, get out of bed.
Yep.
Like, it's all that nonsense. So I think we're going to have to, at some point, assess. But I think it can only really be done after a play has been gone for, like, a number of years.
Yeah.
And then it'll kind of sit. Because I think for somebody who is current, like LeBron is current,
yeah,
or like whoever else we want to put, like, cause again, they're prematurely putting Curry in it too. But we're going to have to wait like 10 years until after someone's gone and then reassess, because then we can then properly contextualize. This is what was going on in basketball at the time. This is what the talent level was at the time. This is what the obstacle was. This is what the numbers were. This is what the performance was like. And I don't think we can do that until we get a little away from it. It's like a girl looking really cute, like from far away, and you get up close, like, ooh.
Yeah, we need a minute. Yeah, that's definitely where it's at. I'm gonna forget about Jordan.
Wait, aren't you out of the age bracket too? That's part of it too.
What? It's funny too, because I think for me, I also like
because I missed Magic and Larry. You know what I mean? So like, yeah, I heard about it.
Yeah, I like just missed Jordan for two reasons. A being born in the 90s and like not being like A being born in the 90s and born in the 90s in New York.
Oh, God. About that.
So, being born in the 90s in New York, fucking being Dominican in New York in the 90s, like, I didn't give a fuck about basketball growing up because of the fact that, yo, Jordan was like, oh, yeah, that Michael Jordan guy. He just beats all the Knicks. So, the only sports that I really cared about growing up was... I liked football.
Yeah.
I did like football, so that's why I'm a fan of the Jets. Did like football. You can't tell, like, I'll sit here and argue to death, like, yo, nah, Curtis Martin was fucking amazing. Like, I don't want to hear nothing about it. He was fucking phenomenal.
Yeah.
I will fight humans for that. Alright? Like, I don't want to hear it. Like, they should have won it. Alright? But then, again, I was able to just, growing up in New York in that time frame, I was able to just like gain so much of my like sports bravado and the fact that the Yankees were fucking demolishing everyone ever. So, bro, like, you can't tell me shit. Like, that's why I was like, yo, like, as far as sports go, like, nah, baseball got me covered. Like, I don't gotta sit here and deal with the trauma of like trying to be a basketball fan and y'all contending with this Jordan guy. And I don't, like, yeah, I'm a football fan, but, like, I don't really got to deal with whatever y'all dealing with over here. I'm a Yankee fan.
Yeah, the Yankees are mashing dudes
for and we, a and, like, and oh this is where I'm having a good time. Like, we having a blast. Y'all should come over here because we having a ball.
Oh, my God. I had to suffer through that, too.
Yeah, like, we having a ball.
I'm sure, you know, obviously, as someone who obviously lived in Providence for a long time, but, like, we forget a lot of what makes up the Providence population or a lot of New York transplants.
Yeah.
And so, going to school in the 90s, early 2000s, just like, because, God, when did the Yankees finally stop winning? Like,
2000.
Even when they had a drought, it was just like, it was recent enough so we could still claim it.
Yeah. Oh, yeah,
you know what I mean? So, like, dudes going to school, Yankees, bro, like, Yankees is the best. And Red Sox hadn't won.
Man.
So, like, and then we got close in 2003 and they blew it. Oh, man, my God.
Oh, man, I'm telling you. It's like being a Yankee fan growing up was like an amazing privilege. Yeah, man. And that's why I still feel like whenever dudes talk about the Houston Astros, I'm very much disappointed in the baseball gods because I'm like, yo, they should be cursed.
Yeah.
Like, how are y'all not cursed? Because the shit that y'all have done warrants a curse. Similar to what the Red Sox went through, the Cubs, the White Sox, it should be a curse.
I felt like how I felt after, like, Daniel snapped his finger and teleported. Like, nah.
Yeah.
I ain't afraid of your axe, bro.
Like, yo, fam.
You're supposed to lose.
Yo, it's trash.
Yeah.
I can't stand it. I can't. Speaking of things I can't stand, while we're on the topic of football.
Yeah.
So, football. The playoffs are upon us.
They are.
Wild card weekend was wild. There are a couple things to talk about. First off, it's super wild card weekend because I completely forgot about the fact that, like, now there's more wild card games. Because
did you check the score, by the way?
Huh?
Did you check the score on the Titans game?
Oh, no, the Titans lost. I lost money, right?
What, it just ended?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
And this is how you know, like, so it's it was 1916.
Okay, let me cross that off.
That just happened.
I had faith in the Bengals.
That just happened. Fucking no, I did too. I put money on it. Cootie, who placed my bet, he hit me up. He was like, "Yeah, I'm sorry, bro. Your family. You don't gotta like just let it be, yo. Let me live. Don't worry about it." But yeah, So, yeah. First of all, when the fuck did Cincinnati get good? Like, that's weird.
The Bengals used to be, like, a joke. Like, whenever you make a football joke, they was the insert team that you would
use. Yeah. They were really bad. They were bad goals. That's a terrible nickname. All right, my bad, y'all. I shouldn't have done that. Okay. But, yeah, Super Wild Card Weekend. Every home team won as expected, but fam, the Cowboys, I thought they were going to win it. I'll be honest. I really thought the Cowboys were going to win.
They would do, but it seems like they always do, though, right? Like, they get really close enough. Like, I don't know, man. Maybe I was just done forever after the Dez Bryant non-catch. When that happened, I was just like, God don't like y'all.
Yeah.
Like, there's nothing else you can do.
Yo, yeah, they're like, they definitely do feel like the Knicks in the 90s, where it's just like, yo, like, y'all should be winning some shit.
Yeah, you have it all. And then even when you get there, you don't get there.
Yeah. I don't know what they were thinking with that, like, last play, that last minute play.
I don't know, bro. Death taxes and the Cowboys making a bad decision in crunch time. It is pretty. I don't remember the last time where I was watching a Cowboys game and I was like, oh my God, that was a perfect setup right there. They should have went with that.
Yeah, bro. I can't figure it out. Like, they should have won that shit. Like, they should have won it.
Yeah.
And they didn't. And I'm very much just.
But they always find a way, though. Like, it's, to me, I used to be surprised about, like, all of the Cowboys hijinks. Now I just kind of expect it. It's just, how are they going to blow this?
Yeah. Like, how's it going to happen this time? I mean, we'll see kind of what. That whole thing, I'll be honest, though, that whole game fucking reeked of Mike McCarthy. Like, that shit reeked. Like, the time management, everything, like, this fucking just, this reeks of McCarthy right here.
Yeah, I mean, so, like, my TL was obviously going crazy like everyone else's, and, like, everyone else I was watching, there was a moment where I started to believe, and I was just like, they really got,
yeah.
Wait, no, why would you, and so, by the end of it, I was just like, Cowboyed again, there's really nothing.
They going Cowboy, that's what they going to do.
That was my childhood team, too.
Yeah?
I, like, loved them when I was a kid.
What happened?
Troy Aikman being retired?
Oh.
Yeah. Like, that's all. We forget. I mean, this is forever ago, but they did have a squad for a little bit.
No, they did. I'm just, I didn't know that you left when the fucking player left. Like,
Troy Aikman was, like, the god to me, bro. Like,
oh, yeah.
When we were having those childhood, you know, playground debates, like, oh, like, Troy Aikman, Steve Young, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Dave was always my guy.
Yeah.
Man, I feel good about that pick because later on in life, when his face started to sag, he started to look like Jay-Z, which is just funny.
Yo, Troy Miller, like, why Jay-Z is the greatest.
So now I'm just down with it. I'm like, cool. Yo, I'm glad I rocked with him.
The divisional round. I mean, we just saw now, as we're recording the podcast, the fucking Titans lost, which I did not see coming, nor did my fucking parlay bet.
I got to check the scores now.
No, nor did my parlay bet. What do you think? What do you think of for the rest of the games in the divisional round? We got Packers Niners, which I mean,
so I'll just give you my picks and like, we can talk about how you feel about it. So I got Packers over Niners, I got Rams over Bucks in an upset, and I got Chiefs over Bills. What you feel?
I agree with Packers over Niners.
Okay,
I agree with that. I think it'll be a lot closer than what people give them credit for, though.
Oh, yeah, I don't think they're going to smack them.
Yeah. It's funny. I was close to betting, like, putting money on Rams over Bucks. And, like, I'm just very hesitant about betting against Brady in general just because I'm like, yo, man, this dude is
But, I mean, do you think dude's going to be Teflon after that whole, like, AB situation imploded? Like, do we think they're still going to be able to get it together, put it together? Like, I don't know.
I mean, looking at what they did last week, like, I kind of see them still being able to be the Bucks. The only thing that I'm kind of wondering is on the Rams end, because the Rams, it does look like all of the, like, wild-ass free agent signings that they did, like, all the, like, getting Von Miller, getting OBJ, getting all these dudes at the same time, it is looking like all the motherfuckers is, like, finally starting to play, like, how you expected them to play.
Yeah.
Because last week, they were bugging out there.
Yeah, I mean, they were wild. But, like, let me clarify, though. I don't think it's going to be, like, a smacking. I think it's gonna be tight either way.
No, no, I don't think any game this weekend is gonna be like a smack.
So I see, the Rams basically like taking it on some like fluke shit at the end.
Yeah, I can see that happening, and I definitely think I think the Chiefs are gonna fuck up the Bills.
Oh, they're gonna roll
that. I think that one won't be close.
I'm not even gonna watch the game. That's how confident I am.
I really think they're gonna wash them boys out. The Chiefs. I think I have mentioned that on this pod before. The Chiefs are like coming into it with very much like a chip on their shoulder. After like last season, they're just like we're gonna like fuck some people up now. Like we're very upset. We are adamantly, visibly annoyed by everything.
I'm always a fan of an angry football team.
Yes.
So
yes,
football is one of the few sports where you being kind of recklessly aggressive is actually to your favor.
Yeah.
Like a reckless basketball player loses the game.
Yeah.
You know what I mean, Westbrook?
A reckless
baseball player blows it.
Yeah.
Like, not really. You need to be in control in most sports. Football is one of the few where, like, you being just a little bit out of control works to your favor.
Pretty much. And that's, like, and that's where I think, like, the Chiefs, like.
Yeah, I don't think it's going to be close at all.
Yeah, I think so, too. Do we know which game this weekend is a Nickelodeon game? Because that shit was fire last weekend. I don't know if you saw any of it.
I didn't watch it. I heard about it, and I didn't believe it when I read it on my phone.
Well, so the funny thing was, I think it was last year.
Yeah.
They tested out the Nickelodeon games. I think it was like preseason or like week one or some shit like that. It was like they're just testing it out. I wasn't expecting that like this year would be full-blown like in the playoffs the way it was, because I think the Dallas game was the Nickelodeon game. And I'm like, yo, fam, like, I'm not gonna lie. Like, if I'm a football team and I'm losing, and I also gotta deal with, like, Nickelodeon slime being CGI'd over, like, like, I'm airing the block out. Like, yo, somebody gotta answer to this shit.
I don't know. So, like, a part of me is, like, a 90s kid. Like, I don't know if you remember. Do you remember Sports Illustrated for Kids?
Yes.
Like, this would have been perfect for that.
Yes.
Like,
yes.
I'm assuming they don't make it anymore because I haven't heard anything about it.
I don't
think. But I remember because I don't know what public schools were like when you went, but like, do you remember having the Scholastic like week where you could like order books and all that?
Yes.
So I used to get Sports Illustrated for Kids every single time. And I remember thinking, my God, wouldn't it be great if like we have like coverage of like sports on Nickelodeon? Because like you would only see football players, baseball players, basketball players, or whatever on Nickelodeon when they were there to get slime, basically.
Yeah. Like they would just show up for the, that I remember.
And so I think this is almost like 20 years too late. I'm interested in seeing like how it plays out, but just like I'm not sure how I feel about it yet.
I do feel like it's so because I agree with you in saying that it's 20 years too late, but I feel like they did it more so for the demographic who was a kid 20 years ago.
You know what I'm saying?
Okay. So like that's where my like marketing brain goes to, where I'm just like, they did this because they're trying to appeal to the, you know, the adult that's in his 30s or 40s who was a kid during that time and enjoyed that whole Nickelodeon sliming extravaganza bullshit, and like would probably find amusement from the nostalgia of like Nickelodeon graphics over a football game.
Well, yeah. So I bring it back to Scholastic Book Week and in Sports Illustrated for Kids. I remember in the publications and like verbally and on the news, actually, there were three debates that were happening like currently around the time. It was like, when are women going to get their own basketball league? When are we going to be able to see sports on Nickelodeon? And then the other one was like, it was about the dress code.
Yeah.
So those are the three, because it was like the NBA, if you remember, was very super anti-hip-hop imagery for like a long time.
Yeah.
Because the NBA was old for a long time.
Yeah.
We only started recently seeing younger players in the league. Like, Kobe was, like, the first young person in a long time.
Oh, yeah. And
the
even
NBA was 35 years old.
And even Kobe, like, he had a way. He was wearing a big-ass suit for, like, the first few years.
And that wasn't even a rule. It was just accepted that you dressed like that.
Yeah.
So, like, it's funny to see all those weird debates that we were having kind of play out in real time.
Yeah.
And then I remember thinking as a kid, though, too, like, on the WNBA, I remember thinking, like, you'll probably get a WNBA and then not watch it.
That's exactly what's going on. And who was it? I think it was Draymond Green on either his podcast or whatever. It was some fucking show that Draymond Green does where they're just like playing dominoes with like other basketball players.
Oh, yeah.
And he had someone from the WNBA on there. He was just like, yeah, like, you know, he watches the WNBA and he loves it.
Because
of fundamentals and like all this stuff.
I do. Women don't.
And yo, and that, and because he was like, the issue is that the majority of people who watch basketball don't know about basketball. They just watch it for the highlights. And, you know, like, that's why they enjoy it. And I was like, all right, cool, fair statement. Mm. But then it's also like, yeah, but like, women don't watch sports in general, that like, in mass.
Yeah, y'all complain all the time to get your own league. Y'all got it and you don't watch.
Like, right? y'all don't watch it, like, as like a general
thought experiment. That pull up to the next girl that you know who's like even casually into sports. Ask her what happened the other night in WNBA. She can't tell you. She can't name a team.
Yo, ask her to tell you, like, ask her to tell, like, yo, literally, all you have to ask is ask her, like, where is the season right now? Like, yo, because honestly, like, I can tell you right now, yo, NBA, it's almost All-Star weekend.
Yeah.
We're coming up on All-Star midway through the season.
Yeah. Ask them to name three players.
Ask them to name three teams.
Now you're playing games. That's too strong. You're not being fair.
Yo, it's such a – and, I mean, I think that's where – I mean, my argument always ends up coming, like, whenever people are talking about, like, the WNBA and, like, the, like, pay gap and, like, all this stuff. I'm like, a fan, listen, like, yeah, like, people aren't watching it in mass. And it's not because they're women or anything like that. It's just, like...
Well, the NBA is a better product. That's the elephant in the room that we don't want to say. I mean, that's true. That doesn't make us sexist to say so. The NBA is a better product than the WNBA. Now, it's still basketball. I respect the competitive aspect of it. But, I mean, a dude doing a 360 dunk versus somebody, like, running and doing floaters, I mean, it's just, it's not the same thing.
It's not.
But, I mean, could you pay them more? Yes. But, like, how much more you want, though? You want LeBron money?
Well, because then that's the issue. Because the issue is that they literally, like, will compare them to, like, what LeBron makes. I'm like, oh, y'all realize that, like, not everybody on that court is making what LeBron makes.
Yeah.
Like, they're not. Like, that's...
Well, yeah, it's the, if you remember a few years ago, Monique was complaining about a Netflix deal she got. She was like,
stop that.
I need to pay I'm not. I'm like, yo, stop. What you want, Cerebral money?
Yo, stop. Yo, stop this. I'm not going to do... Yo.
Like, I mean, how much more you want?
Yo, my dude. I remember when that happened, because it was like, who was she like coming at? Was it... Because I remember, I think she was like on the Breakfast Club talking to Charlamagne about this shit, because she was like, you know, looking at like what Amy Schumer got and what they gave Chris Rock and what and whatever and like Dave Chappelle. And I'm just like, yo, ma,
she was right to complain. The problem was the comparison that she made.
Yeah, like, yo, you not Chappelle. Rock.
She put herself in Chappelle and Rock's, like,
you're not Chappelle or Rock.
I'm not saying she's not talented. I'm saying you ain't Chappelle.
Yeah. Like, and I don't, like, I'm sorry, like, I didn't watch the Queens of Comedy tour. Like, I'm sorry, this shit didn't move me. Like, I'm not here for that.
Alright, it's actually pretty good. But again, Chappelle and you not Rock.
Well, no, it's because she actually went into thinking, well, I'm a queen of comedy. Respectfully. Respectfully. Like, let's...
Oh, my
God. Look, okay,
yeah,
look.
She was definitely...
Because I remember when she... Because that was when she was on the cancel Netflix, like, movement, and, like, nobody went with her.
Netflix is too big to fail, bro.
Yo, fam.
You got canceled Netflix.
No, we're not... I don't...
That's a part of our lives now, bro.
Netflix is too big to fail. Honestly, and because there are people who will sit there and they'll talk about, like, oh, like, when's the last time you watched Netflix? Like, yeah, but I'm not canceling it. Like, I'm keeping that shit still. Because I know at some point something's going to come out that's going to warrant me going over.
I mean, I got suits in my closet I don't wear. I'm not throwing them out.
Thank you. Like, that's just not happening. That's just not happening. And I also just don't think Monique is that funny.
Yeah.
Like,
not.
Not barbershop funny. Like, yeah. like,
would you pay money to... I'm not going to finish that sentence. I'm sorry. I'm not going to waste your time. Like,
nah, don't even... Yeah, like, don't... Like, yo,
too much to waste your
time. Yo, yeah, yo.
I was like, we got lost in the weeds there. I'm sorry. Let's go.
Yo. Just look at the tree before you bark up it. That's all I got to... Like, that's all I got to say. Like, yo, like, I'm not... Like, Monique, you just not... Nah.
Like, oh, my God.
We're not revolting for you. Like, that's not a thing. But much love to Monique.
I think, all right, let me, because I don't want to feel like I'm punching her. I think she's talented. I think she's underrated. I think she was right to complain. She was great and precious. Not Chris Rock. Next question.
What have we been talking about? Before we get into real sports, basketball, what the fuck is going on right now?
With
everyone. Oh. First off, something about this past week in basketball. Is it me or is it just like the number of like flagrant fouls and like referee ejections these last like few days have just been like insane. Like, yeah. Yo.
I'm trying to understand that. And yo, is it weird to me? But like, why does this entire generation of basketball players are just brittle? Like, it seems like there's way more injuries than there used to be.
They all drank milk growing up. And,
like, yo, it's both, like, I remember watching, like, a hard foul playoff basketball in the 90s, and dudes would get a broken leg and be back next game.
Fam, literally, that's, like all Detroit Piston highlights.
Yeah. Yeah, it's, like, wild. I don't get it.
Dudes is hella brittle. Like, well, I mean, I also think that comes from the increase in – like jump shots and like more about like the finesse and the techniques and all that. Cause like dudes in the 90s, like if you really think about basketball players in the 90s, like you can't tell me that like some of them were nice as opposed to the fact that like, nah, like some of them are just big and like strong.
Yeah, so the 90s, like, what it had was they had like a lot of hockey enforcers. So dudes that were just on the team to be goons and like fuck you up when you got in the lane.
Lambeer?
Yeah, like Charles Oakley. He's like, yeah. He was like New York legend. But he was also that type of dude, a dude who, like, bar fights you and, like, all of this stuff. He just happened to play basketball a little. But he was like, if he didn't play basketball, he'd work for the mob as a leg breaker. Like,
100%. Definitely.
100%. Easily. Because he's still that guy. Like, he's still that guy now. It's a really difficult thing to really pin down, though, because it's like you would think that the removal of certain physical aspects of the game would have made it, like, easier on dudes' bodies.
Nah. If anything, it makes dudes' bodies weaker because they're – is no physicality.
Well, yeah, like, so basketball now is flag football. So, like, you would think.
Well, because if you think, but that's where, like, you have to think about when you have this built-in physicality where dudes is constantly, like, getting, you know, bumped around and falling, all that stuff, like, you just build up a higher tolerance and higher resistance to those types of things. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, you just are now more physically,
so
like,
you're saying what little contact you have is like such a shock to the system
that, because you're, like, not used to getting any contact. Yeah. You're not accustomed to any contact.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Because like that's where like you could tell when you're like around it's like when you see like kids in a playground, the ones who grew up with your older brother, the ones who grew up with older brothers versus not, like, you can see the difference.
Yeah.
Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, you can see the difference. Like, some of those kids, like, yo, like, they can take a beating and they're just like, all right,
like,
I'm good.
You can always tell, like, what kid was, like, the baby of the family and grew up around a bunch of his sisters.
Yeah, yes. Like, yes.
You had no older brothers. You had no older cousins.
Yeah. And it was just, like, it was just you around, like, just mad, just female energy. Like, you could see it. It was there. Yeah. It was obvious. Like, all right, bet. Like, but then, like, that other kid who, like, you saw him, like, he jumped off the top of the slide right onto the floor. You thought he snapped his neck. He got up and just, like, kept playing like nothing happened. It was like, yeah, like, you've been through some shit and you could take a beating.
Well, I mean, thank God the technology's kind of got through now, too, because you can come back sooner. But, like, damn. Just like,
yo, dudes is.
Dudes just began hurt. Like, that followed him last night. We got to be honest about that. Listen, I like Grayson Allen a lot, but thank God he's white.
Yo, Grayson Allen. Yo,
he came into the league famous for doing that.
Yo,
I'm surprised he got drafted. I'm not gonna lie.
I wasn't, because I think the reason why he got drafted was because it was like, yo, like he was like you're gonna be Lambeer, like you're gonna be the goon, the resident goon of whatever squad you in.
I mean, in any great basketball team, kind of needs that, right? Like, you need a goon.
You need one.
You need one.
And I remember,
a white goon is like, those are hard to come. You need them. I'll be honest, bro. If I'm a staff on a basketball team and I get a chance to get a white goon,
I'll take him
over a shooter. Give me a white goon anytime.
Fam, the beauty of a white goon is when you think about Grayson Allen. Grayson Allen is a perfect example of it.
Yeah.
If Grayson Allen looked like DeMarcus Cousins, he would have been out of the league a long time ago.
Yeah. This is not the first time he's done it. He came into the league with a reputation for that stuff in college.
Do we not understand the fact that, like, yo, Draymond Green got suspended in an NBA Finals game?
I have never seen that before.
For a, you know what I'm saying? For, like, for like a situation like that where it was just like, yo, like it was an accident. I did a thing, but it was like, nah, you did it enough times, you out. Grayson Allen is still out in the league.
Yeah. And the guy who he did that to was injured.
If that doesn't already prove the fact that, yo, fam, you, oh my like, God. Nah, like, you injured this boy.
That white privilege is insane. Well, he also did it to another white dude. That helps.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Well, so,
yeah.
Like, it's, again, but, like, you get the privilege on the front end, but if you injure a white dude on the back end, the punishment's not severe.
It's not as severe at that point. Like, yeah. I mean, yeah, that dude.
That one is wild. He just don't care.
Man, yeah. Prayers to Caruso. Hope you get better.
Yeah, shout out to Caruso. He's been balling too.
He had, yo, insanely balling, but like, man, I don't know. Going on to real sports, wrestling.
Oh, yes.
Wrestling.
Let's do it.
The two topics to talk about. First and foremost, Cody Rhodes is allegedly a free agent. I call cap, and I'm like, and I'll be honest, this is why like, I don't talk about wrestling on the Varsity Club because honestly, I don't respect none of you niggas. I think like the idea of Cody Rhodes being a free agent because he's technically like no longer in a wrestler's contract deal, fam, he is an executive in this company. Like, that's a completely different.
He's kind of made it what it is, man. Like, it's honestly, I wasn't really rocking with AEW. And so, like, you know, Cody Rhodes was, like, really marketed as, like, the dude. And I was like, yo, Cody Rhodes, like, I'm in there.
Yeah, yo, fam. He, like, because I know some, like, and I think I saw some dudes, like, I've heard some people say, like, oh, well, you know, he's not, like, he doesn't really have any power as, like, a EVS, like, fam. Like, stop this. Like, we're not talking about, forget the kayfabe for a second. This man is running the company. He's one of the faces who runs the company.
Yeah.
Okay? Like, there's a reason he hasn't been world champ yet because it's a known thing. Once he becomes world champ, like, yo, fam, you're running the company and you put the title on yourself. You're automatically a heel, similar to what we saw with Triple H.
Yeah.
Like, that's a different thing. Like, yo, like, he's running it. So yeah. Don't, like, I'm not buying into the rumors of, like, yo, you know, because the same thing, that rumor came on at almost the exact same time when last week there was a rumor that, like, someone's going to be in the Royal Rumble breaking the forbidden door. And people were like, oh, Cody Rhodes is a free agent. It might be him. He might be in the Royal Rumble. It's like, a fam, you're not going to see Cody Rhodes in the Royal Rumble.
Well, first of all, only WWE is dumb enough to let their main star walk at the height of his popularity. And I don't understand how they still do this. But they've done it numerous times. Where you have not only the biggest star in your company, but kind of the number one asset in the business. And because either pride or just like, I don't know what goes on in them buildings, but like you just let the biggest thing that you have going for you walk. Like, only Vince McMahon is like prideful enough to do some stupid shit like that. So I don't believe it. But in a weird sort of way of bigging up WWE, this would be the very type of storyline that they could work into something pretty special. But it's AEW. They're not used to doing this kind of stuff.
No. And I don't think, I mean, I think with WWE, I think the reason why they wouldn't do it is, at least not Cody.
Yeah, no.
Not Cody. I do foresee the possibility of Jericho being in the Royal Rumble. Mainly because.
Jericho's still fat.
A little ethic.
Yeah, that may be eating. Checks is good.
The checks are good. When you get your wrestling promoter to license out your own music to use as your entrance theme. Yeah. Like, yo, fam, like, think about that for a second. Jericho is getting paid to wrestle, and he's also getting paid as the artist who, like, performs the theme music.
Yeah. It's, by the way, the one Fozzy song I've ever liked.
Oh, yeah, it's amazing. Judas is phenomenal.
It does. It's like all those recordings. Cause I remember we used to make jokes about, like, yo, him and his bullshit band. Like, he was really out here. Because, like, when did he start? Like, Fozzy first came out, if I recall, if I'm dating it correctly, like 2005-ish?
Earlier?
Well, it was the first time
I remember earlier than that. Because I think the only reason why I say it was earlier than that, because I think it was because when Because when he initially left WWE in like 2003, it was because he just wanted to do Fozzy full time and wanted to like take the break from wrestling. And I remember it might have been like around maybe like 2002, 2003 ish that like the band started. Like, because that's when they like started really like promoting the band on WWE as well. It's like Chris Jericho. Because I think he also had a different name. He had a different name as part of Fozzy. Like, I gotta find it. He had a different name.
Please don't make me lose respect for Chris
Jericho. On everything, bro. Like, he had a different name.
I love him, man. He's the top 10 wrestler of all time. I can't do it. Don't make me.
His stage name was different as part of Fozzy.
Didn't Jeff Hardy start like a bullshit band around that time, too?
Don't do this.
I could have sworn he did. It was called something stupid, like Paroxygen or something. Yep. It was something stupid.
Probably.
I gotta look it up.
Oh my god.
I gotta look it up.
Yo.
Jeff Hardy had a bullshit band and Chris Jericho had a bullshit band too. They were bullshit band brothers.
Yo, bullshit band brothers. Yo. Definitely bullshit band brothers. There we go. Yes, I found it. So.
Oh my god, I found it. Parox Y Gen. Right there. Parox Y Gen.
Yeah, that's terrible.
Yeah,
so the band started in 99.
Oh, why?
Yes. So the band started in 99. I remember it was early 2000s when they were when they first showed the band Fozzy on WWE television. Mm-hmm. They wouldn't refer to the lead singer as Chris Jericho because he had a different name, a different alter ego. That's why when I saw them, I was just like, is that not Jericho? Because they're not calling him Jericho. The name, because that was like Jericho's alter ego, was Mongoose McQueen. So he was Mongoose McQueen for like years before then he was just like, all right, yo, the jig is up. Y'all know it's me. Like, he don't wear a mask or nothing, but it's like, yo, y'all know it's me.
Like Shock G and Humpty Hump. Just never had him in the same place at the same time.
They were just never in the same place at the same time. But
there goes Mongoose around.
Nah, he's not. He'll
be at the next show.
Yeah, he's at the next one, though. He said he's going to meet us at the next city. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, my God.
Yeah, Mongoose McQueen.
Damn.
Yeah.
I got to take some points off him. Sorry.
Yo.
I have to.
Can't stand. Question. While we're on the topic, you said Jericho's top 10. Do you really think Edge is top 10?
So I do, but I'm also kind of fucking with you when I say it.
Because I'm like, yo, y'all are wild to say that Edge is top 10. And also, too,
so like my top 10 ranking of anything is always like, usually my top 5 is pretty solid, right?
Meaning
they're not going to ever be moved for any reason.
No,
the bottom 5 are fluid.
Yes,
and
I can
agree. The higher we get, the more interchangeable they are.
Absolutely.
So like if... By the time I get to round 8 or 9 or 10, the top, the bottom, like 2 or 3, could actually leave depending on what happens.
Yeah.
So that's where I have Edge. If I have Edge top 10, he's 10. He's not 1.
No. Of course. I don't think he's 1.
Yeah, motherfuckers are talking like when I said Jericho's top 10. So, and really when I say that, I mean he's worthy of top 10. It's not, he's not solidly in the top. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So let me explain my objective ranking system. So, whenever we're ranking GOATs, right?
Uh-huh.
I think the problem that we do, both in sports, music, or whatever, especially like rap music, because that's when we tend to really care the most. Like,
yep.
Like top basketball players, top rappers. My system is the same, which is like, the problem that I'm foreseeing is that we're having 3 separate arguments, and we're conflating them. And as a result, we're not actually resolving anything. So there's, who's your favorite rapper or basketball player, right?
Yep.
Which is, your personal opinion. Who do you like to watch? Who are you into?
Yep.
Who do you follow, right? Which is, you're not taking into account any of the other stuff. It's just, who does Izzy like?
Yes.
Right? Then there's GOAT, which is where I think where it starts to get a little murky, right? Which is, we're encompassing what? Skill, era, talent, competition, accomplishments, record set, records broken, feats, trophies, blah, 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 all that stuff, right? That's usually where Jordan is. Then we're talking, which is the most interesting one, which is just, who's the best? Talent in a vacuum. Just skill, period. Eliminating. So that's, if we're relating it to rap, that's where I'd have L. Big L would be like top 3.
Yeah.
We're just talking talent in a vacuum.
Yeah.
We're not talking about album quality, body of work, none of that. Just, if you put him in the booth, who's the best spitter?
Yeah, like who would give you the best, like the best 16 right there?
So here's the thing, right? So to contextualize it, I think Jay-Z's just talent in a vacuum, one of the 10 greatest rappers ever. But he's not high on that list. Jay-Z couldn't outrhyme Big L any day of the week.
No, I don't think so.
I think he's top. He's up there.
He's up there, but like.
But he's not, no. Like, I wouldn't put him up there with like a Big Pun. Like, Pun is another one when I heard him rap. Like, forget the radio records. When I heard his other stuff, I was like, whoa.
Man, the first time that I heard, what was that? The deep cover, that Twins joint. And I was just like, yo, what the fuck?
Right. So he had a style that was like 20 years into the future. Like, who could you name right now, a modern rapper, who you think is a better bar-for-bar rapper than Big Pun? You'd have to sit down and really think. And then whatever you come up with is probably wrong anyway.
Yeah, like, it's tough. That's a tough one.
So that's my ranking system. So the question is, what are you really asking me? Are you asking me talent in a vacuum? Are you asking me greatness? Or are you asking me who I like?
So I think, well, who you like, that's...
Right.
You can't argue that.
But see, that's the problem, though, right? Because we start combining those arguments.
Because that's the difficult part.
So dudes think they're arguing GOAT, but they're arguing who they like.
Well, yeah.
Or they think they're arguing skill, but they're arguing...
Because if you argue, like, who I like, Rob Van Dam will forever be the greatest motherfucker of all time in my eyes. Like, that's... will forever be, like, my personal GOAT. Like, yo, RVD is that dude every way, shape, or form.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Who, if you ask me, yo, but like, who's the greatest of all time? Like, in like wrestling wise, Shawn Michaels.
And then stop it right there. Now, the third argument, talent in a vacuum, personal opinion out of it. Wrestling talent, who's just top? You know what I mean? That's a different argument.
That's a different one, too. If you're putting it like in a vacuum, like, who's going to give you like just one great match right there, right now, going to deliver something amazing?
Right. So, like, Kid Dynamite would be. Top three, if we're talking talent, just wrestling talent, to me. Like, I'm taking my personal opinion out of it, right? I don't have a lot of his matches that I necessarily care for. While, like, you can see the talent, they don't necessarily hold up like that.
Yeah.
It's just, but when you look, you can see ability.
Yeah, it's it's craziness.
Yeah, the ability is just off the charts, right? But he wouldn't be the top of your GOAT list.
No.
He wouldn't be the top of your favorites.
No, because there's not... He can only get in on this.
So if you're really... And this is probably what kind of solidifies any GOAT debate, right? So if you're talking... Jay-Z is one of the few that land on every list. High.
Yeah.
Right? He'd be one of your favorites.
Uh-huh.
He's talented in a vacuum, and he's greatness.
Yep.
But so that's really the measurement. So, like, that's tricky.
I think for me, when it comes to where Edge falls in for me, on all lists, is that he was never, I think because of the fact that, like, he was good at so many different elements of, like, wrestling when it comes to both tag team and singles and character and, like, in-ring ability and, like, all this stuff. But I don't know if I put him in the great category on anything.
Yeah.
And when I say great, I'm talking, like, I don't put him top 10 great on anything. Because of the fact that, like, for example... So I think I talked about this last week when Tap was here. I was like, if you're thinking of, because, like, in what would you put him in top 10? Because if you get to, like, in-ring ability, like, I could ring off 10 motherfuckers who I think were better in the ring than Edge. If you think about just overall GOAT, like, I can think of 10 people who I think were just greatest, like, overall GOATs.
Yeah.
And then if you think of, like, all right, well, what about, like, character work and, like, gimmicks, like, I could think of 10, because then when you get to that point, you're getting down into, like, the Mr. Perfects of the world. You know what I'm saying? Like,
God, I love Mr. Perfect.
Bro, but, like, that's where it gets difficult.
God, I love Mr. Perfect.
But that's what I mean then, because now you're... Because with Edge, he's, like, one of those people who, like, is, like, concrete in my, like, top 15 to 20 on every category.
Yeah.
But because it's so, like, just from, like, a volume standpoint, there's so much great... It's hard to put him in a 10 for any of it, because
and so everybody's metric isn't the same. That's number one.
Yeah.
And so, like, the way that we sort of allocate points to certain individuals, an era matters too, and when you came into certain people.
Yeah.
So it's like, if you saw Undertaker in 2018,
Yo, stop this. Yo, I'm not gonna let you do this. Yo, I'm not gonna let you do this.
I love Singer. I think he's underrated too, actually. Versus seeing him in like, even because Undertaker is almost like Jordan, right? He has three primes, if you really think about it.
Yeah, absolutely.
Like, he has 90s, then he has early 2000s. Like, he changed his gimmick, which, by the way, makes no sense in retrospect. But
I thought it was great. I'll be honest, I loved it.
I liked it, but, like, again, it's almost like when you see, like, a horror movie that you saw when you were a kid.
Oh, yeah.
And then you look at it years later, wait, we just let him become a biker? No one questioned it?
Yo, no one questioned, but I think that's why I loved it, because of that. We were just like... Yo, and I mean, it makes sense too. When a motherfucker's around that long, like, you gotta change some shit.
You gotta,
too. Because I'll be honest, I had that same idea, that same thought that you had.
Yeah.
I had in 2004 when he came back as a dead man. I was just like, yo, wait, he was a dead motherfucker, and like no one said anything about this. Like,
wait, you have powers?
Like, wait, hold on, wait, what? Like,
create lightning, and you were hanging dudes 5 years ago.
That's the part that got me, too.
I love how we just forgot that part. Like, bro, no one ever talks about Ministry Undertaker.
Yo, no one talks about just... No one talks about, like, yo, he put Austin on a cross. And, like, no...
Man, this man was wildin'.
Yo, it was a crazy era. But I think that's where, like, for me, again, because of, like, people like that, when you start thinking of, like, you know, Austin, Rock, Taker, Angle, Triple H... Like, you start, like, Lesnar. You start getting into, like, a solid, like, 10. It was just like, I don't know if I'm putting any of these.
Yeah, so, like, again, so if you're objectively ranking something or trying to.
Yeah.
The question really isn't, is someone, whatever number with a bullet, are they absolutely solid and movable? The question is, can you argue it logically? So, it's like, what we're trying to avoid is blasphemy, right? It'd be like me arguing Ultimate Warrior top 5 ability.
No, I'm not doing that. You know, ain't no way. Nah.
You couldn't say that in any room of any wrestling fan because you'd be laughed out of the room. So if I'm saying Edge is top 10, I could break it down empirically and argue it. The question is what I'm saying inarguable from a logical standpoint? Now, obviously, I could, if I really wanted to, I could push Edge down to 20 if I wanted to push it that way.
Oh, of course. Edge is, I don't think it's, I just think for me, when it comes to the conversation of Edge being in the top 10, I don't think that it's something that's inarguable, because I think definitely, like, anyone with, you know, if you're knowledgeable enough about wrestling, you can go ahead and make the argument. I think for me, where it comes, the question that I always have in that discussion is, like, who would he be over? You know what I mean? Like, that's really, like, I think when it comes to just, like, the, like, just straight up meat and potatoes of it, who would he be over then?
Yeah.
Because that's where, like, my question ends up being, like, all right, like, do you put him over a Kurt? Do you put him over? Because you have to remember, too, from a volume perspective, when, you know, when you talk about, yo, my top five is, like, pretty concrete, and it's that, like, 5 to 10 that's, like, movable.
Yeah.
Knowing what I know about you, and you and I being in very similar eras of, like, wrestling fandom, I'm pretty sure that in that 5 to 10 is where the Kurt Angles, the maybe the Brock Lesnars of the world, you know what I'm saying, maybe the Eddie Guerreros, like, that's where all of them are playing, you know what I'm saying, like, that's where they're all shuffling around, and that's where I'm like, who's Edge over on this side over here?
Well, so then that's where it kind of gets tricky though, right? Because one of the wrestling minds I respect is like Jim Cornette. His top 10 includes nobody we care about.
Oh, my God.
Like,
it's all,
like, he's wild.
Oh, yeah,
He has, like...
I already know, like...
I'm trying to remember what the names he had on. I was like, really?
Yeah.
Like, you have them? Like, because... All right, so just... I can't remember the names off the top of the head. But, infamously, there's, like, no one you would, like, immediately recognize as someone who's worthy of being on your list that you would compile.
Yeah.
So, there's no, like, Austin.
Of course, of course.
He loves Rock, and Rock doesn't crock top 10. Like, you know what I mean? Like, that's...
Jim Cornette is, like, he's the equivalent to, like, an old head in the barbershop talking about basketball.
Yeah.
And, like, arguing the fact why Tiny Archibald should be in everyone's... Like, he should be in everyone's top 10. Like, listen,
oh, my God. It's, like, funny you say that, because I've known some people who've actually argued Tiny Archibald, and I'm like, get out of my face.
Yo, like, yo, hey, listen. Like,
respect to history, but damn, yo, stop.
You never watched Tiny Archibald. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, yo, fam, like, No, I'm not finna sit here and try to argue Stone Cold Steve Austin versus Bruno Sammartino. Like, I'm not doing that.
So, you know, there has to be an aesthetic quality to any type of argument like that, too. And obviously, the closer we get to the modern era, like, it's going to lend itself to an argument that's in favor of the current generations because there's a lot more data to go off. Whereas, you know, look up a Bruno Sammartino match. Like, putting aside the lack of ability in comparison to today, but just, like, go back and watch one of the matches, bro. Like, it's not as much technique, you know, and part of that is because, obviously, we didn't know as much about the wrestling business. There were moves that hadn't been invented. But, bro, like, no. There were watchable dudes back then. Like, we can make those arguments in a vacuum, but we also have to contextualize properly. So, like, if we want to go back into time and say wrestling wasn't it then, well, like, I can actually show you some wrestling that was actually good.
Yeah.
Like, Ric Flair was nice when he was young.
Oh, phenomenal.
You know what I mean? Like, he had it all. Like, yeah. Now, the gimmick wasn't necessarily fleshed out yet, and he had some stuff to work through. But you could see the raw ability was there.
Of course.
Like, go and look at, like, early Tito Santana.
Yes.
That dude was, like, stupid. Yes. For his time, he was stupid nice.
Tito was amazing. Steamboat.
Steamboat. Oh, my God.
Steamboat was phenomenal. You mentioned Sting around me. I'm not listening. I'm sorry. I only mentioned that because I think it was – I was watching AEW Rampage.
It really kills me that he's still wrestling, by the way. Go ahead.
But because I'll be honest, anytime that AEW promotes that Hook is having a match, I'm watching. Every time. Like, I don't know if you've watched one of Hook's matches. This guy's fucking nice.
Yeah.
For those of you who don't know, Hook is Taz's son. And he's fucking so, like, everything about the way that they've, like, packaged this kid is fucking phenomenal.
Yeah.
He's like a Division I college athlete. Has to be in his, like, early 20s.
Yeah.
And, like, he's one of those, like, just very careless. Like, I don't think I've ever seen him smile. Like, he's just super – it's pretty fucking amazing. I love
everybody. Sidebar, what race is Taz?
I think
– I've been trying to figure this out for years, and nobody answers me. No one knows.
I feel like he – anytime I think of, like, Taz, and I look at Taz, I always think of –
like, if you told me his daddy was black, I'd believe you. But, like, also, there's, like, some Middle Easterny. There's some, like...
Yeah, I feel like it's... let's see. Let's just look it up. But, you know, it's, like, the power of technology. All right. So, Taz is... Of course, it's not the first thing.
It's more than three things. If you say it's one thing, you're lying.
There we go. Personal life. Italian.
And what?
Just Italian.
And what?
It just says he's of Italian descent. His last name is the most Italian shit I've ever... Yeah, it's like... His real name is Peter... Sinercia? He's Italian. From Brooklyn. Yeah. 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 Yeah, man. Yeah. And he has a son who wrestles, who's also Italian, but like a much like lighter skinned Italian.
Bro, Taz is my color. What are you talking about?
Yo, I don't know, man.
Taz is my complexion. You're talking about
Italian. Hey, yo, hey, he's getting the privilege, man.
He got a lot of sunlight then.
Yeah, yo, hey, must be. But Hook is amazing. Okay. So I recommend you watching this joint. But in my journey of like my quest of trying to watch a fucking quality and amazing Hook match, fucking Sting was on the card as well. And I'm just like watching this and I'm like, yo, when was this ever cool? Like
Sting died in 1999.
Yo, fair. I've never
That's what I'm doing to all my people who stopped going on too long.
I will forever because I know some people who will like, that's a very blasphemous statement to say that, yo, like, you don't really, like, fuck with Sting. Mm. My thing will forever be the lack of realism to Sting in the ability to, like, yo, like, I'm supposed to believe that this man can clear out a whole ring throwing chops. Like, look, I'm not buying it.
Yeah, I mean, I understand that. So, but again, we have to make these arguments universally. Like, so while I think that's a valid argument, Undertaker had lightning that shot from his fingers.
I'm not. Fam.
We gotta...
Yo,
it's wrestling, bro. Like it's either all okay or none of it. Like, you get mad and do clear the ring with chops and a bat. Yes, I've been in a project. I know a bat doesn't beat 25 people, but I mean, Undertaker was like hiding in Randy Orton's mirror.
We're not going down this rabbit hole right now.
Triple H like drug Stephanie McMahon and married her, man.
Illegal marriage. Which,
all
right,
he's not, that ain't all he did. If that's what he did, by the way.
All right, but, we, man. Yeah, all right, yeah. We'll get it. We'll get it. In other news, while talking about AEW, Jon Moxley has made a return, which was that motherfucker looked good.
Yeah,
that motherfucker looked good.
Like he was drinking water.
Yo, yeah, he looked healthy as shit. Did you see Bully Ray's comments?
I did. So, all right.
So, all right. So, for context, Bully Ray commented on Jon Moxley's return. Jon Moxley took a leave of absence, essentially to go to rehab because he was having problems with, like, alcoholism and just, like, his demons. He just needed to go and get fixed up.
Respect due.
Bully Ray's response was pretty much in response to, like, his return and, like, his first promo back. Bully Ray was just kind of saying, yo, you didn't, pretty much like, yo, like, you should have apologized to the fans for leaving. You should have given some sort of, like, recognition of, like, just an apology to the fans for having gone away and not been there. Like, you know, there were fans who paid money because they wanted to see Jon Moxley and Jon Moxley wasn't there. What are your thoughts?
I, much like in the vein of that criticism, I think, you know, the idea that Jon Moxley should have apologized to the fans, I thought Bully Ray should have shut the fuck up.
Yeah, I mean, yo.
Like, why did you need to say anything?
Yo.
Like, that's such a weird, forget the take itself. Why would you open your mouth with anything other than, like, a welcome back?
Yo, like, yeah, like, you don't, I mean, I get it. You gotta, like, you're on a radio show. You gotta do your shit. But I'm like, yo, fam, like, motherfucker just came, like, he openly said, yo, I gotta bounce because I gotta, especially thinking about wrestling where so many wrestlers we've lost.
I was just gonna go there, bro. Like, wrestling has an abnormally high body count.
Because of the fact that they do not take breaks to handle their demons and deal with their issues. They literally will go through and, like, till the wheels fall off and will not take a break.
I think Brian Pillman, his whole saga is, like, perfectly, like,
bro.
I hate to put it that way, but, like, it's the perfect example of, like, yes, what happens, like, in the business.
Bro, Pillman, Guerrero, the list goes on and on. It's like, yo, like, these people should have taken a break. And we might have, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, really strengthened the possibility that they would have still been here.
Yeah, so the problem with wrestling, and they've never really resolved this well, but the pressure of the business and, like, retaining one spot is, like, so ridiculous that, like, you'll have, like, a nagging injury and not want to take it off because, God forbid, you get, like, bumped out of, like, the title picture, and then you go to the mid-card, and they stop using you on TV, and, like,
yeah,
hell yeah, I'm applauding anybody who does that. But again, going back to the Bully Ray part of it, it's like, bro, it's like, so I'm reminded of this mantra I used to go by, like, you should never really miss an opportunity to shut the fuck up.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, is what you're saying need to be said?
And I wish he would have just taken that opportunity.
Why did you need to comment on it? It didn't need a commentary about it. Just be like everybody else. Glad to see you're healthy. Glad to see you come back.
Yeah.
And glad you leave it at that. Or don't say anything.
Yo, like, glad you good. Like, yo, hey, man, cool.
Yeah. How dare you take care of yourself?
How dare you go and not apologize to these, like, your fam, like. You don't owe the fans that.
I like the fact they did, like, the fact that I saw the video of Jon Moxley telling somebody to go fuck themselves.
Yeah,
that made me really happy.
Man, I loved every bit of it. Bully Ray gotta relax.
When that world championship went to his head.
Yo, where's Bubba? We didn't forget.
I was never down with the whole Bully Ray thing anyway. Mm-mm. When he was, like, this big brainless doofus that powerbombed people through tables, that was cool. See, that's why everybody shouldn't have a speaking character. Some dudes need to be all action. Brock Lesnar doesn't try to talk. He knows what his role is.
I come in, I hurt people,
Yeah, I'm here to slam dudes.
I'm here to slam people. You ain't never lied. Speaking of I'm here to slam people, just our last topic of the day, UFC 270 is upon us. I love this card. I am excited for this. Big meaty men bumping meat. What are your predictions?
So I'm gonna go through the first two that I care about. I'm gonna go with Nick Carr first. I gotta go with Pereira, man.
Okay.
I know a lot of people have actually gone the other direction, but I don't know. So Pereira's one of the dudes who, like, every time he fights, I'm just like super excited to see him. Because he does something amazing every single night.
Yeah.
His style is like really, really bizarre and like interesting. Yep. Like I always wondered if like what would happen if one of the like really like lesser known martial arts made it into like UFC. Like if someone was like showed up with like monkey kung fu, what would you do?
Yeah, yep.
Like if someone did drunken style, what would you do? Like, cause we've never seen that before, and like logic suggests that it can't really work in an MMA setting. Yeah, but we say that until it actually happens.
I mean, I also think that just like all of the instances where that would have happened, though, I think have kind of come and gone in the UFC and MMA in general.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, when you think about, you know, when fucking when jiu-jitsu first hit the scene, like had fucking wrestlers in a frenzy, like trying to figure out like how the hell do I deal with this thing?
Well, yeah, jiu-jitsu owned MMA for a long time because it was just like dudes hadn't seen it. They didn't know what to do with it.
No. But then...
And so you had a leg up. And then, you know, the industry caught up to it finally.
And then I feel like that's kind of happened, like, across the board. And then you started thinking about, like Muay Thai.
Yeah.
Like, then dudes are trying to figure out, like, yo, how the fuck do you deal with this Muay Thai striking? Like, motherfucker grab my head and knee me. Like, how the...
Yeah. I didn't know what he's going to do when he grabbed my face.
I had no idea. I didn't know that was a thing. And lo and behold, I had a knee coming to me. I had no idea how that was coming. Like, and then dudes figured out, like, it caught up.
Yeah.
So I'm kind of wondering, like, what other styles of martial arts are even, like, out there?
Well, yeah. So that's when I get excited when I see a dude like Pereira, because he's always kind of giving something new. Like, he's a creative striker, and I've just always loved creative strikers. Like, anybody who knows me knows I, like, love Anderson Silva.
Oh, yeah.
And so that was the height of everything to me. I don't think there's ever going to be anybody who, like, gives what he gave. So whenever I see like a new style of someone who's really creative with how they do stuff, I'm just always riding with that dude until he gets knocked out.
Yeah.
So I don't suspect he's gonna lose. And then I gotta go with Ngannou, bro.
Really?
I don't feel comfortable. Let me put it that way.
Okay.
This is the first time I haven't felt comfortable riding with Ngannou. Like, I think he could lose this fight.
Something about Ngannou is, well, cause like, this is technically his first title defense, but this dude feels like he's been the fucking champ for, like, ever.
Yeah.
But this whole story and, like, the way everything is built up and this whole contract situation is, like, easily the most interesting thing I've seen in MMA in a long time. Like, I would love to see Ngannou win just for the sake of, like, seeing a motherfucker, like, really take UFC by storm and, like, hold them hostage for some shit. But like, my brain does feel like Ciryl Gane is gonna like get it done, because this motherfucker.
Oh yeah, he could definitely lose.
Like, yo, Ciryl Gane is just like he's just like a whole. He's an animal.
Why do they both look 7 feet to me?
they
look mad huge,
bro. I think Phil has said, he was like, yo, like, they should just put like tiny buildings like in the fucking cage and just like have them like break that.
That'd be really good marketing.
Yo, it'd be like fucking like they look like two characters from the game Rampage. Like they are fucking huge.
Yeah. Ngannou looks like if you were able to like take a transformer and make him anthropomorphic.
Yo,
like if you could take a truck and turn him into a human being,
it would be Ngannou.
It would be Ngannou.
It would definitely be Ngannou. And what do you think about the flyweight? I think Brandon Moreno.
Yeah,
I got Brandon Moreno. Yeah. Something about just the way the first two encounters went. You know, first one being a draw, and then Moreno winning it. The second time around, like, the third time, it reeks of Fury versus Wilder to me.
Yeah.
Where it's just like, all right, first one's a draw. Second one, I got you.
It was clear, but we were playing games.
And now, like, the third one is like, what you think is going to happen, B? Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, I get it. Like, Davidson, is, like, he's been training with Cejudo and all. I'm like, fam.
I don't believe that. Whenever somebody, like, tries to put me on to some new... Actually, wasn't that one of Wilder's excuses, too? I got a new trainer now.
You got a new trainer. Yeah. Like, I got the new trainer. I'm doing this. I'm like, yo, fam.
Yeah, because he's like, who was I talking to about this? And I was like, I knew he was losing that shit because he was out there practicing combos in the back of a bodega or wherever he was training.
Yeah, it don't work.
The gym didn't even look regulation.
It don't work. It
doesn't. First of all, you're not going to relearn how to fight in 2 months, dude, and come back and, like, knock off the best dude in your class. It doesn't work like that.
That's not how that works. And that's where I think Moreno's gonna win it and just keep on rocking. I'm definitely gonna be watching that shit. That's actually going on a little later on tonight.
Burn.
Yeah. It's still in the undercard, like the prelims right now. So, the prelims are going. They're like, second fight of the prelims. So, might go to brass and watch this shit. I don't know. I'm still figuring it out. It's a cool, bro. I don't know. Right? Like, that's pretty much what it is.
It's like legit. Like, if I stayed here and this is my podcast, you'd leave and I would go to bed. it's official. Once I go back in the house, I'm done with it.
Yeah, I'll be honest.
I get miserable when I'm cold, bro. You got one chance to get me. If we try to link up, I better already be outside.
I'm not gonna hold you. I can respect that. I think that's where like I'm. That's why I'm on the fence. Cootie had hit me up. He's like, "Yo, going to brass. Yeah. We're gonna watch some fights over there. Pull up if you want." I was like, "All right, I'm gonna let you know how I feel after the pod." I don't know how I feel right now.
Yeah, dudes hit me up because they've been hitting me up like a few times since I got back or whatever. And dudes are like, "Yo, we try to go out. We try to link up." I'm like, outside? I gotta go downstairs and get in my car and then drive to you? When I leave where we at, I gotta go back into the cold to get in my car to drive home? And then, because I don't leave my heat, running when I'm out.
No.
I act like somebody who's trying to save money still. Because, I'm a tortured soul. I grew up poor. So, all I hear, in my back of my mind is my grandmother complaining about the bills. Mm-hmm. So I turn my heat down way low. And then when I get back home, I got to wait for it to build back up because I was out with your ass. Or I just go home and be warm.
I just stay warm. Man. Yeah. So we'll see if I end up doing that shit. Who knows?
You ain't making it.
I
you ain't enthused about it at all. You trying to talk yourself into it.
Yeah, I'm trying. I'm trying to be optimistic about interacting with other people outside of this podcast, because I've started to realize too that my routine has become I only really meet up and talk to other people if they're gonna be on the pod. So it's like, oh man, you want to talk to me, you better come do this pod.
Solitude is very dangerous.
Yeah,
I find that I'd rather be home where all the people I like live, and all my food is there.
Yeah. Yeah, all the snacks you could ever want.
All the snacks. I ain't got to share nothing.
It's beautiful.
You want to see me come by.
It's so beautiful. Shit, man. I'm hyped you came through, man. I'm hyped that you had hit me up after you got back and you was just like, yo, man, I'm trying to do this pod one more time. I was like, yo, fam, you ain't got to say nothing but a word.
I knew it was only going to happen if I did it then. Because I think I might have said it to you in the text. But I was just like, yo, while I still have the nerve,
because
I'll start thinking about it, and then I'll get locked in my routine, and then I'll not want to do anything anymore.
Yeah.
I still, had a little bit of that, free spirit, African
energy.
Yeah, going on.
Yeah.
So, while I was still up for anything, but now I'm back in New England, and it's cold, and now I don't want to do anything anymore.
Hey, man. Well, glad I got you before you got fully cooled down from that, from the heat. Appreciate you pulling up. Appreciate y'all. Yo, y'all still here to listen to all this bullshit, man. I appreciate you. All right? If you hear this, love you. All right? With that being said, I will take us away. Some ships float, some ships sink, but the best ships are friendships. And to those ships, we drink. Cheers, brother. Cheers.
Shout out to 90s hip hop.
Shout out 90s hip hop, baby. Shout out Big L. Shout out all the legends. Alright.
Shout out to Lil Yachty.
Yes. Shout out Lil Yachty. Alright. As always, peace, love, all the above. Come back next week. See who I got here with me next week. Peace. We out.